Ich kann ja auch sagen, jetzt der Fracture-Mechanismus, ein gesättigtes Microcardial Fracture. Und Microcardial Fracture works via so Mechanismus Void Nucleation, Void Growth und Void Coalescence. Also Bohrenbildung, Bohrenwachstum und Zusammenwachstum. First we will start with void nucleation. Here a useful model is Ashby's model for void nucleation. And that considers a single particle in a large matrix. And the matrix material is plastically deformed. And we assume that the particle is rigid and cannot deform. However, the matrix material, even around the particle, would like to deform like if the particle would not be there. Okay. And okay. Now you see a region of the matrix material directly around the particle, the rigid thick line of the particle. If the particle would not be there due to that plastic shear deformation, that hole in the matrix material would become an ellipsoid. Yeah? And, but that cannot be unless the bonding between matrix and particle material is not disturbed. If you assume that the bonding remains a perfect bonding between matrix and particles, the matrix material has to accommodate the rigidity of the particle. And it will try to do that first by elastic deformation. That means near the particle, a high elastic stress will occur. But then, if the deformations are too large, plastic deformation has to be initiated to accommodate that misfit in deformation. What means plastic deformation? Plastic deformation is the generation of dislocations. And how can we now generate dislocations so that misfit between the deformation behavior of the matrix and that of the particle can be accommodated? What you see here on that side, a gap occurs between particle and matrix material. And in order to close that gap, we can generate here rings of dislocations. And you see the dislocations end here. And if I can generate here such an array of cylindrical dislocations, then that gap can be closed and the matrix material is shifted towards the interface of the particle. On that side, it's different. The different case. Here, there is too much matrix material compared to the particle here, and how can we generate again dislocations in order to close that misfit by cylindrical Weil ich habe da Generation of Cylindrical Dislocations, like I have flag shape here. Yeah? Okay. And now we come back to flag figure. And that is exactly what is plotted here. The mechanism is called plastic bunching, and it can, in reality, it can be observed in a transmission electron microscope when you make an in situ deformation of a matrix material around such a particle. Okay. So, in general, there are two ways, two different ways how a void can be initiated, how a void can be nucleated in if I have such a configuration of a particle inside a volume of matrix material. One possibility is that the particle fractures, and the other possibility is that a decohesion occurs between matrix and particle. Maybe I go back to the last picture here. I have forgotten to say that in any case, due to the accommodation, due to the plastic bunching, high stresses occur near the particle. And that high hydrostatic stresses, they form the driving force for such a void nucleation in form of either particle fracture or matrix particle decohesion. Okay. Now we can write something like an energetic condition for void nucleation that is similar to the energetic conditions for crack propagation. We have a driving force that helps to nucleate a void, and we have a resisting force that wants to hinder the nucleation of a void. The driving force is, again, is of course the strain energy that is in the surrounding of the particle due to that high hydrostatic stress state. And when we go back, we see, let's assume that we have a loading of the matrix by a load stress sigma infinite. And then that release of elastic energy when such a void nucleation occurs, it is clear that a free surface is generated after void nucleation, and that means that high stress reactivity is reduced since I have free surfaces generated. Yeah? And, and now that release strain energy is the release strain energy of one volume element, that is just one half sigma infinite squared divided by Young's modulus, if I have just an elastic deformation near the particle, and the released volume. And the released volume is certainly somehow proportional to the radius of the particle. Yeah? And so we can write that released strain energy will be in any case proportional to sigma squared divided by E times the third power of the void radius. On the other hand, a free surface is generated after void nucleation, and that means we need additional surface energy. And that surface energy will be equal to a proportional to the specific surface energy, gamma naught, times the radius of the particle. It is clear that in both cases, either particle fracture or particle matrix decohesion, the free area of free surface will be proportional to the particle radius, to the square of the particle radius. Okay? Good. And then, if we have then the condition that the release strain energy, that means the driving force for void nucleation, must be equal or larger than the resisting force, then we come to that equation that for the energetic condition of void nucleation, that load stress must be higher or equal to the square root of gamma naught times the Young's modulus times the radius times the inverse of the particle radius. Yeah? And that means if we have large particles, if rho is large, the stress will be smaller than if we have very small particles. Okay, in fact, we can see also in experiment, we can determine the critical Kresge Bobonen displacement of a material that fractures in a microductal way. You see here, that was the initial crack, that has opened, and in front of the crack tip, a first void has been nucleated. In the actual position of that void, there was a particle located. And we can determine from that critical stress Bobonen displacement at the moment of void nucleation, and from that, and the material was manganese sulfides, and from that criterion, we can determine that Kresge Bobonen displacement at the moment of void initiation is a function of the manganese sulfide diameter. And you see that if the manganese sulfides are thick, that CTRG value is low. If they are small, then the CTRG value for void nucleation is large. Okay? And from that, we can calculate even that critical stress at the interface between manganese sulfides and iron matrix, because it was manganese sulfides in steel, depending on the radius of the manganese sulfides. Okay. Okay, so that ends our discussion of void nucleation.